This UCSD TV program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest programs.
We are the paradoxical ape. Bipedal, naked, large-brained, long the master of fire, tools, and language, but still trying to understand ourselves. Aware that death is inevitable, yet filled with optimism. We grow up slowly. We hand down knowledge. We empathize and deceive. We shape the future from our shared understanding of the past. CARTA brings together experts from diverse disciplines to exchange insights on who we are and how we got here. An exploration made possible by the generosity of humans like you.
So I study ice cores, and I am just an armchair admirer of the people who study evolution of humans. So I'm very pleased to be invited here, and I hope I can contribute something. My outline is that first I'll take a little sort of digression away from the topic of human evolution, just to give you some background on what's happening right now and how, for example, do we know that humans are causing the current climate change? And then I'll talk about the observations made by many other people, not myself, that agriculture seems to have originated precisely when we had the most recent of these abrupt climate change events, 11.7 thousand years ago. Some people call that the end of the Younger Dryas period. And it's really quite a stunning coincidence, and it probably isn't a coincidence. Many people now believe that the warming and the wetting allowed humans to switch from a hunting and gathering mode of existence to an agricultural mode of existence. And then I'll go on to talk about abrupt climate change itself and what causes it. I'll tell you the punchline, which is that we think it's the switching on and off of ocean circulation, and I'll wrap up with the question, will it happen again in the future? So, my little digression, the smoking gun of human causation. I love this diagram, and you don't see it in the media very often, and I think it's just a shame that we don't, because it really is a very powerful form of evidence. And if someone asks you if you believe in global warming, you should say no, because it's not a matter of belief, it's a matter of evidence. So this is from the ice cores, I'm proud to say. This is my field of ice core science. We know from the bubbles trapped in the ice cores that CO2 in the atmosphere was at about 280 parts per million for most of the last 1,000 years. And then right around the time of major coal burning, around 1850, it started to creep up. And so here we are today at 400 parts per million. And at the same time, this rare isotope of carbon that Peter Domenical introduced to you, carbon-13, in the atmospheric CO2, from a change from a very stable value, don't worry about these units, and it started taking a nosedive, and that's the signature of fossil fuel burning. If the CO2 was coming from the ocean, which is the major natural source of CO2, it would not have done this. It would have been flat. So this really is the smoking gun. You can say that with great, great confidence. And of course, there's a lot of other lines of evidence, but I like this one in particular. The other thing that you can do if you're confronted by someone who doesn't buy this argument that, you know, CO2, how do we know that CO2 actually causes climate change? You can look to our neighbor Venus, which has about 3,000 times more CO2 in its atmosphere than our planet. And it has a surface temperature of 450 degrees centigrade, which is hot enough to melt lead. So it's basically a combination of Venus, basic physics that tells us that CO2 traps heat, and these undisputed measurements of CO2 concentration and its isotopes. Those three things taken together pretty much sums it all up. Everything else is kind of details. We know that humans are embarking on a dramatic future change of climate. It doesn't really matter that much what's happened up until now. I mean, asking whether the Earth is warming or not is kind of like driving towards a cliff and asking, are we dropping yet? You know, it's not really that interesting a question, actually. And while I'm on the topic of smoking guns, this is a very famous picture that many people have seen, the CO2 concentration from ice cores, and here we are today at 400. So you see, it is quite unusual in the context of the last 800,000 years, which is the whole ice core record. I'm working on trying to extend this back to 1.5 million years. You can ask me about that later if you want. But the important thing about this, that this is not the smoking gun of human causation. There's been an awful lot of confusion about this. Al Gore, bless his heart, I think kind of led us down the wrong path by implying that this was some kind of evidence for that CO2 causes climate change. In fact, it's mostly the other way around, that Antarctic temperature is related to the things that control natural variations in CO2, and the current CO2 spike has nothing to do with these variations. It's not coming from the ocean. As you saw from the carbon-13 evidence, it's coming from fossil fuel. It's a completely different chemical, in fact. So if somebody gives you a hard time about the fact that the CO2 changes slightly after the temperature, you can tell them that's expected because it's natural CO2 and it's responding to climate. It's not causing climate. And a related myth is that the ice core record that you've just seen shows that carbon dioxide rose after temperature began warming at the ends of ice ages, which is true. That's why it's in black. Ergo, carbon dioxide does not cause warming, which is false. The fact is that ice ages are ended by the changes in the Earth's orbit, as you heard earlier today. So it's not surprising that the temperature changes first. And you can think of CO2 as a feedback that amplifies the initial warming by about 30% probably. It's not a huge, it's not actually a huge increase. It's maybe, you know, 2 degrees bigger of a change than you would have gotten otherwise. So humans are adding CO2 directly to the atmosphere, and so ice ages are not a good analog. It's a red herring. And just, I couldn't resist showing this because it's such a nice analogy. If you overspend your credit card, you go into debt, then you have to pay interest, right? And then it makes more debt, okay? So interest lags debt. How do we know that interest adds to debt? We can't explain the total size of the debt without taking into account interest, and also economics tells us. And climate of the past now, we have the Earth's orbit causing warming, making CO2 rise as the ocean warms and outgasses CO2, and that causes further warming as an amplifier. Okay, so that's the whole end of story about human-caused climate change. Now I'm going to move on to this idea that the first evidence for agriculture was seen during this abrupt warming. So this is a fascinating topic, and it was mostly, I think, the work of Brian Baird, who used to be here at UCSD, who discovered that the very, very first domesticated plants, I think they were barley seeds actually, were occur within plus or minus 200 years of this abrupt warming event right here. Seeing it, this is actually the Greenland temperature, but it's a lot of the northern hemisphere European temperature as well. And then this is a methane, atmospheric methane record from the ice core, and it seems to be a proxy for wetness. So there's a great deal of increase in northern hemisphere low latitude rainfall at this time. And this all happened in about 30 years. These are very fast events. There was about half of the temperature change seems to have occurred in 1 year. So these are the kinds of things that could impose very large stresses on humans, potentially, because there's not enough time to adapt. And so what's amazing about this is that people seem to have completely changed in a very short time their mode of existence from hunting and gathering to farming right here. And it's probably because everything got so much warmer and wetter that it was just really lush. Think about the Garden of Eden, okay? So that's probably sometime in here. We don't know whether it was 8,000 years or 12,000 years, whatever. Yeah. So anyway, that was an example of abrupt climate change that probably greatly benefited our ancestors. Of course, when it's cooling, it's drying as well, and that would be a period of intense stress, and there were probably population bottlenecks at the time. And those may be very important for evolution, because if you kill off 97% of the humans, and you just leave 3%, those will have characters that will then be able to spread widely without having to exchange with a large gene pool. And so you can get very powerful evolutionary change through these bottlenecks. And what's remarkable about these abrupt events is they happen again and again. There's not just one of them, there's 25 of them in the last 100,000 years, and probably, you know, something like 20 in the 100,000 years before that. And so all told, our ancestors probably went through at least 100 of these bottlenecks. So it's a repeated form of boom and bust. And William Calvin had a very nice book about this kind of boom and bust evolutionary pumping hypothesis. I'm going to switch now to talk about the physical science understanding that we have about abrupt climate change, what causes it in the first place. And as I hinted at the beginning, it's something to do with ocean circulation. Warm water at the surface in the North Atlantic is carried by currents to this place around Greenland, where it becomes cold and dense enough to sink. And then it travels southward, along the bottom of the ocean. And what this seems to do is it actually displaces the Earth's thermal equator north of the geographic equator. And so the northern hemisphere today is quite a bit warmer than the southern hemisphere. And we believe that, from theory and evidence, that this circulation is capable of shutting off. And so that's what a cooling is. And when it turns back on, that's what an abrupt warming is. And so this is kind of what the paleo records look like of this phenomenon of shutting on and turning on and shutting off the North Atlantic circulation. In northern records, you see abrupt warmings at the times when the circulation goes on. And in the southern hemisphere, this is Antarctica, you actually see a gradual warming during times when the north is cold, and then an inflection point towards cooling, gradual cooling. In the south. And this is very strong evidence that this really is the ocean circulation. This is from a very recent ice core we drilled that just finished, and we got published in Nature a few weeks ago. And this is one of the main findings from this ice core, is that because we can now date the two hemispheres relative to each other to a precision of about 50 years, we can show that the northern abrupt warming leads the southern transition to cooling, which is shown here, by about 200 years. And that's very interesting, because that really confirms that this is the ocean circulation that is doing this. So I think it's the latest in a long line of pieces of evidence that support the notion that it is this ocean circulation sort of oscillating and flipping on and off that does this. Will it happen again in the near future? Is an abrupt climate change something we have to worry about? Well, you may have seen the movie The Day After Tomorrow. And so it's something that's permeated into the public consciousness, but I think the answer is probably not. And the reason I say that is that the Atlantic Ocean is getting saltier today. In the last 50 years, it's increased its salinity dramatically. You can sort of see that in this cartoon here. The Atlantic is all yellow, which is an increase in salinity. The Pacific has a lot of blue, and that means sort of a decrease in salinity. So what's going on right now is that the Atlantic is getting saltier, the Pacific is getting fresher, and that's exactly what we expect to happen in a warming world, because warm air holds more water vapor. And so it's possible to transport more vapor out of the Atlantic into the Pacific across Panama, you see here. And so basically, whenever the world gets warmer, the Atlantic gets saltier, and the salt actually densifies the water, makes it easier to sink, and it actually protects that circulation. So while there was some worry maybe 15 years ago that the Atlantic circulation would shut down due to global warming, I think we can say now we've learned something, science moves on. It is now very unlikely that this will happen again. And the other thing, of course, is that we don't have the amplifying factor of sea ice. Sea ice makes the ocean turn from dark to white, and so it greatly exacerbates the effects of the overturning circulation shutting off. So my take-home message is, hope I've convinced you that abrupt climate change did stimulate farming, and it's a very, very interesting story that's only just beginning to be understood. It's very probable that many, many abrupt climate changes prior to this one that stimulated farming played a role by creating bottlenecks that made the survivors of this event able to radiate out into an empty niche after the event. And very, very probably, I think, also encouraged people who could do things differently than their parents were doing them. And as I have some kids who are becoming teenagers, I know a lot about this sort of oppositional, don't do what your parents were doing kind of stuff. And I just wonder if maybe that teenager kind of thing has its origins in abrupt climate change. Because, you know, if your parents are telling you to eat fruit and the climate just crashed, and you say, well, I do things differently than my parents, I'm gonna eat roots instead of fruits, well, you might be the one who actually survived because you're a root eater. So I'm just wondering if maybe these population bottlenecks somehow encouraged sort of contrarian thinking, you know, sort of Atlantic Ocean overturning circulation is the culprit, I think, we can say now, that causes abrupt climate change. Will it happen again in the future? Probably not. That's one thing we can breathe easier about. Check that one off the list. More salt, less sea ice in our future. Thank you.